great to be with you this morning. Thanks so much for being with us and gathering to worship our God. What a great morning it's been so far. I mean, amazing worship, right? Amazing worship. And the great things, the women's ministry stuff coming up. I was so glad that we got the announcement right this morning about that, by the way. Whoever sent out a text this week, it said something like this to everybody, to come to this evening of pain instead of paint. I don't know. It might end up being an evening of pain for some of you. I don't know. But it's an evening of paint, not pain, again. So just so you know, got that clear. Well, again, it's great to be with you this morning. I wanted to give you a quick update just so that you know, just to be able to pray about something before we dive into God's Word. Pastor Jeff Bucknam, as we all know, who gives oversight, leadership to all of our church here at Harvest, he recently had a medical procedure done on his heart where they put a stent in. And we just wanted to let you know about that, just so that you could be praying for him. He is recovering really well. Things are going well. But we just want you to know to lift him up in prayer as he continues to recover and goes through that process. So we would appreciate you doing that. He's definitely a valuable man here in the kingdom of God. We love him, and we want to make sure that we care for him properly as well as he does his recovery as well. So why don't we just take a moment before we open up God's Word and just to bring him before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your kindness to us. Lord, thank you so much for Pastor Jeff. And Father, as he continues to recover and is on the mend from the procedure he had, Lord, we just pray, Lord, that you would give him your joy and your peace, not only to him, but also to his entire family as well. And Lord, restore him to full strength and health, Lord, that he might be able to dive back in again. And Lord, we just pray that you would lift up his spirits and encourage him on this day. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, most people, I think, live fairly normal lives. Fairly normal lives. Normal in that they fit into the culture that's around them, right? Well, I mean, we kind of all do that, right, to a degree. We fit into the culture. But then there are those who just live strange lives. Strange lives. For example, the man, apparently he's from Iran, who is known as the dirtiest man alive. Apparently he has a personal revulsion to personal hygiene. The claim is that he's not actually cleaned himself for 60 years. Okay. Don't go visit him, apparently, unless you got some soap. Then there's the man from Britain. Maybe you've heard about this guy who actually lives as a dog in his spare time. It's a hobby for him. Apart from his spare time, he normally functions, but he does this thing where he actually dresses like a dog on his spare time, eats out of a dog bowl, and plays with dog toys as a hobby. And then there's the man who absolutely loves to live with cockroaches. The perfectly healthy woman who has chosen to live as if she's paralyzed from the waist down, even though she's not, and yet she actually dreams and hopes that someday she might be paralyzed. That's strange, isn't it? There's the family that lives as if it's 1986. That's maybe not all that strange. I mean, I haven't been in some of your homes, but maybe your decor is still there. I mean, the 80s were great. Then there's the woman with 1,000 cats. Now, that one really I don't get. I don't know why you'd want one, even. I mean, I'm sorry, cat lovers. I'm sorry. I'm a dog lover. But 1,000? And then there's the man who spent the last 26 years of his life traveling the world with a giant crucifix on his shoulders. I mean, these are just kind of strange things, right? I mean, the vast majority of people look at these sorts of people and likely think that these are the kind of people that need counseling, like they need therapy or something. This is not kind of the way that we function and operate in culture. All of them live such strange lives, not the norm, lives that run opposite to the way that most people live. And they get our attention. And when you choose, or when I choose to live lives that are different than the culture that's around us, people consider us strange because you don't fit in. It's like you don't belong. It's like you're not part of this world. Like, what planet did you come from? Let's face it. I mean, nowadays with Instagram, you just got to scroll for a while and you're like, wow, what universe are we even in anymore? This is bizarre. Well, as we come to our text this morning in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, all the way to chapter 2, verse 3, Peter gives us four commands in this passage that I want to pull out for you this morning, four commands regarding us as followers of Jesus and how we should live or conduct ourselves in the world or the culture in which we live. Commands that are, quite frankly, as we look at these four, are so countercultural, so against, in many ways, the way that the culture around us functions and operates, just as they were for that first century group of Christians that were scattered abroad in those various areas that were introduced to at the beginning of the book, Cappadocia and Asia and Bithynia and Pontus. If followed, these commands cause us to be seen as strange to people. Strange, and people would view us as not really fitting in, maybe a little odd, maybe not as odd as the Catwoman, but odd nonetheless. To bring us up to speed this morning, last week we looked at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 all the way to verse 12, and in that message last week we talked about how Peter outlines how great our salvation is. He begins with the words in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to God for the incredible salvation that he has given to us." And then he proceeds to tell us about that salvation, how we have been born again. God caused this miraculous new birth in our lives, and that brought us into a living hope that he gave to us, a hope about eternity. It gave, as a result of that, we have an inheritance now that nobody can ever take away from us. We also have, because of this incredible security, because that inheritance is being kept by God for us, and he's also guarding us while we walk through this world to make sure that we actually get there in the end. And then Peter still goes on in that passage to say, and by the way, Jesus Christ is coming back. Like, church, you have a ton to hope for because of the salvation that you've been given. It's with all of that at the background, you see, what Peter does in that first section is he lays out for you and I a number of statements, declarations that are just truths. None of them actually have anything to do with what you and I have done. They're just, he caused you to be born again. He gave you his mercy. He has kept you. He is guarding you. He's coming back. Those are all declarations we grab hold of, you see, because here's the truth of what we need to see next in the text. Commands, when they're given in a text, when God gives commands, they come after his declarations. In sort of official language, we call the declarations imperatives, or I should say indicatives. Okay, these are statements of fact, statements of reality. Chapter 1. Peter now, in chapter 1, verse 13, is turning the corner. He begins to give commands, and he's going to give four of them to the church. But the commands come on the heels of the declaration. It's the indicatives that come first, and then the commands come. You see, when we get it backwards, we get it all wrong. We're never supposed to put the commands first. You see, the commands make sense only after we have come to understand the great truths of the gospel, that Jesus Christ died and was buried and raised to life, and that he has given us eternity, that we have been born again. And out of that, once you've been born again, commands make all sense in the world. Because I'm not seeking to earn favor with God or merit it. Now the commands are born out of a life that's changed, that's transformed. Now these are the way that I express my love and devotion to Christ. So that sets the stage for us as we look at this text this morning. Four commands that, if followed, will indeed make us seem strange to the culture around us. So let's take a look at those one by one. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn in on the chair Bibles that are underneath the seats. If you don't have a Bible, you can pull one of those out. I believe you pull to page 1014, almost the very end of the Bible. Okay, head over there, and you will be able to find 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. It'll also be on the screen, some of the passages as well. So let's take a look now at these four commands. First of all, here's the first one. In verse 13, Peter says to live in hope. live in hope. This is his first command. He states it this way, therefore. Now, as I've already mentioned, what Peter's doing at the very beginning here, he uses the word therefore, and how many times we always hear this? When you look at the word or see the word therefore, you ask what the word is there for, right? So it's pointing us backwards. He's saying right here, in light of all that I've just said to you about this incredible salvation, all the great declarations about you being born again and having this living hope and an inheritance, in light of all of that, number one, I want you to live in hope. Live in hope. Therefore, he says, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. When he says revelation of Jesus Christ, he's talking about his second coming, when he will be revealed to the world, when he will return back to earth here in glory. Now, as you look at this passage, it might look to you on the surface that there are three commands here. Prepare your minds for action, be sober-minded, and set your hope fully on the grace to be revealed. Technically speaking, it's one command and two what we call participles. I'm not going to try to take you down a long tunnel of language and that kind of stuff to explain this. I just want to break this out so that you can see how this text makes sense. The command actually in this passage is this. It's when Peter says, set your hope fully on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's the command to set your hope on the return of Jesus Christ. That's what Peter commands here. And what he does then is he tells you, while you're doing that, while you're waiting for Jesus Christ to come back, while you're setting your hope upon Jesus Christ, while you're waiting for his great return, while you're doing that, prepare your minds for action. And while you're doing that, be sober-minded. He's talking about the disposition of a follower of Jesus while we live in this world, while we're waiting between now and the second coming of Jesus. How do you live? You live with your eyes fixed on Jesus. He is the hope that you're looking for. But you have to position and posture yourself in this world in such a way that you actually believe that. That you're actually living that way and are expecting his return. I wonder if you live in that hope, in the reality of this text. When you think about your day-to-day existence, would you think of yourself as one who sets your hope on his return? I think sometimes if we're honest with ourselves, and I'll throw myself in that category, we might find that we don't think as much of his return. I think years ago, people thought a lot more about the return of Jesus. I think so. There's been some sort of weird shift in the Christian faith where we don't talk about the coming of Jesus as much anymore. It's probably an overreaction to people who have tried to map it out in every single detail that you can possibly try to map it out, and you just got tired of it. But the reality is Jesus is still coming back. That one singular truth needs to be held near and dear to our hearts. But why is it? Why is it maybe that we don't think about the return of Jesus? And I think there's really two very simple, straightforward answers to that. And I think one of them has to do with we may just be preoccupied. It's not an intentional thing, like I just don't want to think about Jesus coming. Sometimes it's a fact that our hearts get preoccupied living in this world, don't they? The other thing is that we're often comfortable. We're often really comfortable. Edward Donnelly, in talking about heaven, he's asking the question, why is heaven so neglected today? Like, why are we not really thinking about the glories to come and heaven and the coming of Jesus? Like, this is our hope. Why are our eyes not fixed on him and the future? He simply says, because we're too comfortable. For the most part, we're reasonably healthy, tolerably happy. We're fairly rich in a sense, in contrast to most of the other parts of the world. Life is sweet, and without realizing it, we are drugged by well-being and prosperity. It's so true, isn't it? I mean, the real honesty is that we all live in that orbit, that world, right? Like, we might say, well, I'd sure like to be more prosperous. Well, okay. The reality is, when you have it so good, it's hard to have a longing for something else, isn't it? But Peter's audience wasn't like that. Peter's audience didn't have what you and I have today. If you remember in 1 Peter, what's going on there, they are on the sort of front end of suffering. They're moving in sort of a trajectory or sort of a trackway of from insult and ridicule and mockery eventually to full-on suffering in terms of martyrdom and death. Where are we on this spectrum? Have you been insulted because of following Jesus lately? I know I haven't. I talk about Jesus all the time at Starbucks with people. Right? Like, so it's not exactly like we're in a position, and maybe you do get some insults for following Jesus, but you see, the first century church, the people that Peter was writing to, they didn't have really this preoccupation with this present world. They weren't living in a life that was too comfortable. These are our challenges, our cultural challenges. And this isn't a statement for me to say, let's beat ourselves up because of the culture that we live in. I mean, shame on us for being like living in this culture. No, it's the recognition that this is a war for us. We have to be conscious as followers of Jesus that we have this tendency to become too preoccupied, this tendency to be too comfortable, and we have to fight and resist against that. Because those are the things that drag us away from Christ. They drag us away from the hope. Now you strip that stuff away, tragedy strikes in your life, the rocks or the floor falls out, the ceiling caves in, and what happens? Man, do we become desperate for Jesus, don't we? I've seen it in my own life. You've probably seen it in your life at points. And if you haven't yet, you will. And it's then we realize that he's all we've got. And so Peter here in this passage says, set your hope fully there. Don't hope in those other things that are really not truly hopeful, that are just wishful thinking. So he says two things. He says, prepare your minds for action. So while you're setting your hope on Jesus' return, number one, prepare your minds for action. What does he mean by that? Now, literally, quite literally in Greek, it's gird up the loins of your mind. Like, what in the world is that? Girding up the loins? All right. Yeah, I'm down with that. Let's gird those babies up. So what is this? Well, it's a picture, okay? It's a picture of what, you have to understand sort of what happened back in the day. Back in those days, I'm glad that we don't do this around here today, the guys wore the long robes, okay? I'm not really into wearing the long robe thing personally. But if you wanted to move somewhere quickly, like apparently they're really comfortable, right? That's why they wore them. They're really comfortable. A lot of like sort of air circulation and all that kind of jazz. So in kind of a drier climate, hot, okay, fine. But what they'd have to do if they wanted to move quickly is that they would have to bring up their sort of garment and then they would tuck it into this belt so that they could take off and run. You see, and Elijah did this in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 46, where all of a sudden he had to pull up his garment and hit the road running. This is the picture that's behind this. Peter is pulling from that and he's saying, listen, while you're waiting for Jesus to come, while you're setting your hope, the disposition that you need to be in is one where you are ready. You've girded up those loins, like you've picked up your garments. You are not standing around and waiting just haphazardly. You are ready to go at the very moment the Lord calls. A number of years ago, when I was a teenager, 5 or 6 years ago. I don't know why everybody always thinks that's funny. I was at my cousin's house. We were best friends growing up. He's a pastor today, and we weren't believers at the time, didn't know Jesus, but we were hanging out at the house, and we were watching movies downstairs. It was like 3 a.m. I woke up. We all fell asleep. I woke up, and I was like, okay, why am I laying down on this cold basement floor? This is dumb. I am going to go upstairs and take one of the beds. So I snuck upstairs, and the bedroom, when I walked in through the door, I had to reach around, and there was like a light that I could hit, and it was on dimmer switch. And I hit it, and when I hit it, facing straight this way is a sliding door leading onto a patio. And I hit the dimmer switch, but it was really dim when I hit it on. It was like just really dim. But I looked straight out that window, and there was a guy standing there with, I think, was probably a mask. Either that or he was just really hideous. It was like a really old man mask, if I can put it that way, with this long kind of white hair. And I'll tell you what, my heart went from about like non-existing to like about to explode. And we looked right at each other, and I screamed at the top of my lungs, and this guy took off. And once he took off, I realized, okay, I'm not imagining this because I can hear his footsteps all the way down the stairs. Man, by that time, I'll tell you what, now I was courageous. I went from a coward to super courageous. I woke up everybody in the house. We grabbed golf clubs. I think that's what we had. I mean, it's like 5 minutes later, okay? We're out of the house in the backyard, my cousins and I. We're like, where is that guy? Like, he's going to be hanging around there, right? What really struck me about that day, I've never forgotten that, because I thought, what would have happened if I didn't wake up? I mean, it reminds me of this great text, right, in Luke chapter 12, verse 35, when Jesus said, stay dressed for action. It's the same meaning here when he says, prepare your minds for action, or girding up your loins, and keep your lamps burning, and be like men who are waiting for their master to come home from the wedding feast, so that they may open the door to him when he comes and knocks. Blessed are those servants when the master finds, whom the master finds awake when he comes. Are you awake? Are you prepared for his coming? Truly I say to you, he will dress himself for service and have them recline at a table, and he will come and serve them. If he comes in the second watch or the third and finds them awake, blessed are those servants. But know this, that if the master of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would have not left his house to be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. This is Peter's point. Live in expectation, friends. Live in preparedness. And not only in preparing your minds for action, being ready to go, but also being sober-minded. Metaphorically, he's talking about the sobriety of mind, mental alertness, being self-controlled as you are waiting and watching with a hopeful disposition for Jesus Christ to come back. And Peter wants you and I to live that way. Let's face it, most people today in this world, they have hope, but it's not this kind of hope. This kind of hope is a strange kind of hope. This is a strange way to live when you live with this kind of hope. Most hope in this world is temporal, but we have hope in things in eternal. Most hope is imperishable things in this world, but we hope in the things that are imperishable. We hope in the things that are certain to happen. They're a sure thing, but the world hopes in things that have no certainty, no surety to them whatsoever, and no guarantee. We can set our hope on a sure thing, and that's what Peter wants you to do. So as you wait in hopeful anticipation of his return, wait in readiness, gird up the loins of your mind, tuck in your robe and be ready. And as you wait in that hopeful expectation of his return, be sober-minded, sobriety, clear thinking, self-control. Peter's point is so straightforward. Set your hope on Jesus. He's coming back. Be like Martin Luther. He said these words, live as though Jesus Christ died today. Died today, or died yesterday, rose today, and is coming back tomorrow. Hear that again. Live as though Jesus Christ died yesterday, rose today, and is coming back tomorrow. You see, that's the kind of living that Peter's calling us to. It's a strange way to live. For the world does not live like this. And yet we are strangers in a strange world, and this is how Jesus calls us to be. Secondly, I want you to note, in verses 14 through 16, that Peter says to live in holiness. So live in hope, but secondly, live in holiness. He begins in verse 14 by saying, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance. But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. This idea of being holy is really basically to be set apart for God, right? God is himself holy. The text tells us that. It quotes from a passage in the book of Leviticus where it says that you shall be holy, for I am holy. God is set apart himself from all that is unclean, all that is impure. He is perfect in holiness. He's never, ever had even the slightest bit of stain. We have. As followers of Jesus Christ, those who've been born again, he calls us then to be like him. We now, because we're born again, actually have the capacity through his Spirit to actually live for him, to be holy. J.C. Ryle, a great author, by the way, if you ever get a chance to read J.C. Ryle, a little bit of an older thing to read. In fact, most of the really good stuff is written by a bunch of old dead guys. The new guys just really kind of piggyback off that, and they're never really as good, frankly. But J.C. Ryle is one of those old guys. Here's what he said about holiness. Holiness is the habit of being of one mind with God. According as we find his mind described in Scripture, it is the habit of agreeing with God's judgment, hating what he hates, loving what he loves, and measuring everything in this world by the standard of his word. He who most entirely agrees with God, he is the most holy man or the most holy woman. A holy man or woman will endeavor to shun every known sin and to keep every known commandment. He will have a decided bent of mind toward God and a hearty desire to do his will and a greater fear of displeasing him. This is a key piece, a greater fear of displeasing him than displeasing the world. And a love to all of his ways. That's what a holy person's like. So God, give me more holiness. Peter's saying, live that kind of a holy life. Notice what Peter does in verse 14, though. He says, don't conform to the passions of your former ignorance. These people had a former ignorance. They had come to know Jesus. They had been born again. But he's saying, now don't conform your life to that. You see, to conform to your old way of life or to conform to the cultural values that are around you that are against those values that are taught in God's word, to do that is the exact opposite of being holy, isn't it? A person who seeks to be holy must not conform to the world. Instead, the text tells us that we are to conform ourselves to Christ and we're to be holy. Paul put it this way in Romans chapter 12. He said, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So don't conform, transform, right? Don't conform, transform. And you do this in view of God's mercy. You look back at the mercies of God, the mercies of God. Peter talked about this in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, didn't he? He said, you have been born again. God has caused you to be born again according to his mercy, to his great mercy. When you're a recipient of God's great mercy, you recognize, I don't deserve this. That's what mercy is all about. God caused me to be born again. He brought this about in my life. He's changed my life. My natural response now is out of that is to say, Lord, I don't want to conform. Rather, I really want to see my life transform more. I want to be more like you, Jesus. So I ask you this morning, are you loving what he loves and hating what he hates? Are you loving what he loves and hating what he hates? To hate what he hates is not to hate people, and I think we got to be clear about that. You know, one of the things, I'm just going to kind of a little sidebar, and I shouldn't do the sidebar probably, but I'm going to go there anyway. You know, we are so politically charged in this country, it's unbelievable. Like, it really is. And I'm not going down any road, please, I hope you hear me. I'm not making a statement at all about any particular candidate or at all. I'm not doing that. What I want to say, though, is this. Man, we can forget to be Christians and all that stuff. You know, I mean, there are people, yeah, who are coming into our country, but there are also people that are here, and some of them are legitimate with needs. And we've forgotten to be Christians sometimes in the midst of that because we don't like something. We're called to conform our minds to Scripture, not to the pattern of this world. And we have to do real work in our own lives to say, Lord, where have I become cultural in my thinking, and where am I actually biblical in my thinking? That's the key. You see, because we serve a different king, and we have a different citizenship. It's in heaven. It's not here on earth. Yeah, we have a citizenship here, But our ultimate loyalty is to the one and only true King of Kings and Lord of Lords, King Jesus, and he is the one we will actually answer to ultimately. So we want to form and shape our lives and what we do as God's people around that and around his kingdom. So are you loving what he loves and hating what he hates? To hate what he hates is not to hate people, because he's not hating people. He loves people. Quite frankly, there's a lot of sin out there in the world, isn't there? There's a lot of things that deeply bother us. If you're a follower of Jesus, you look at it. Scroll through Instagram. Scroll through whatever you've got. You see it all over the place. Watch the news. There are people that need Jesus. And God hates sin in whatever form it comes in. But he loves people. And he hates the sin in us as well. But he loves us. So we need to ask ourselves sometimes those questions that are hard when it comes to holiness. What are my thoughts like? What are my attitudes like? My actions? What's my entertainment like? What shows do I watch? What movies do I enjoy? What social media things do I participate in? When I'm with others, how do I speak of others? Ouch, right? This is the kind of stuff that we need as followers of Jesus to pay attention to. I don't say these things from any place of perfection. God knows that I'm far from that. But I have to say what the text says, and the text speaks to me too. You see, when we choose to live holy lives, people who do not know the Lord will likely consider us to be strange. They will. Because who seeks to live like that? Thirdly, in verses 17 through 21, Peter says to live in fear. He says to live in fear in this passage. I mean, what is with that? What? Live in fear? Here's what he says, starting in verses 17 through 21. Yes, live in hope, for sure. Live in holiness? Yes. Live in fear? Wait a second. I don't think we're supposed to be fearing, are we, as followers of Jesus? Notice what he says here, though. Starting in verse 17, and if you call on him as Father who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. Conduct yourselves with fear. Why would Peter in this passage tell us to live or conduct ourselves with fear? Remember, this whole passage is about how you and I conduct ourselves in the world in which we live in. But it doesn't sound right that we're supposed to live in fear. Conduct yourself with fear? But here's the thing. Peter is not telling us to live in fear in the sense of that sort of when fear grips you in the middle of the night or during the day and you have that sort of wave that comes over your body, if you've ever experienced that, because I know I have, wave of heat that rushes over your body. It's called anxiety, right? That you just go, what in the world is this? And you have to breathe through it, and you have to quote scripture. Like all that kind of stuff, fear and anxiety and stress and worry. He's not saying to you and I, hey, live in that. That's great. You see, because we do that naturally and normally. We actually don't need any help with those kind of fears. They are there in our lives. The kind of fear he's talking about is very different. Peter's telling us to fear God. That's what he's saying. Not in a paralyzing way. Not as if sort of God is this God who's just going to beat you down because he's so filled with hate. No, that's not it either. But fear here carries with it that idea of reverence, of awe. I would suggest to you today that somewhere over my life of following Jesus, I've seen this kind of almost disappear as followers of Jesus. We almost never talk about fearing God. It's interesting, isn't it? 1 Peter 2:17 specifically says, fear God. Fear God. If you want to memorize a portion of a verse, that's it. Fear God. But we do. We live in a significant time of biblical imbalance where we have an enormous amount of emphasis in this day in which we live upon the love, mercy, kindness, goodness, and grace of God. And those are wonderful things. These are true things about God. But we can live in imbalance because we hear very little sometimes then about the holiness of God, righteousness, justice, wrath, and the fact that he is the judge of all the earth. Our fear of God, that is our fear of God for those of us who are followers of Jesus Christ, has to do then with this idea of reverence and respect, the sense of awe that we would have of him, that God is wholly other. He's wholly other. He's perfect in all his ways. He is love, and yet he's also the holy and righteous judge, and our text tells us that. Peter is saying, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, throughout the time of this world in which you live in. But he's just finished saying, if you call on the Father who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourself with fear. Why? Because he is the judge. There is still coming a day of judgment. We're not going to be judged the same way, but there is still an accounting that happens. We still stand before a holy God. For this reason, we should tremble before him out of reverence and awe. But if I can kind of put it this way, and this is going to not really be a perfect example because a human parallel is never sufficient. My kids, I don't know if today, they're all grown up, but they grew up fearing their dad. And you might think, well, that sounds horrible. No, it's not. Because my kids also grew up knowing that I love them. And I'd do anything for them. And a lot of you as dads, you get that, you know. You didn't drive fear into them. You didn't do things that made them afraid. But there was such a respect for you as a dad that they didn't want to go against you. And if they did, they knew that there was a line, and they met that line, and then they, you know, revisited the line, and then they revisited it again and again and again. And they learned respect. They learned a little measure of like, okay. I remember Chuck Swindoll years ago in his book, The Grace Awakening, telling the story of when he was, I think, 13 or something like that. Yeah, he'd become a teenager. He's now 13. And his parents were out in the backyard, and they were working in the yard, and he was supposed to come out and help. And his dad said something like from down in the yard up to his window in the bedroom, like, hey, Charles, you need to get out here and like help us, right? Like, you got to come out here. And Charles looked at the window and said, I'm not coming. I'm not coming. I'm 13. I can do what I want. And he commented in his book, like, my dad, like, broke the record for the 100-yard dash or whatever that day. He goes, he was up in my room and all over me like white on rice. He said, so fast. He goes, I got a licking on that morning from my dad. And, man, I was down there in the garden and I was pulling weeds. But later that day, we were all out for a wonderful birthday celebration. You see, it's that kind of a picture, isn't it? I hope you understand that what I'm saying about that, and maybe if you didn't grow up in a home where you had a good father, it's hard to maybe understand this. I mean, frankly, I didn't grow up with a dad in my home that was a good man either. I didn't even know my dad. But I know what my dad here is like, and as a father. I'm grateful for his discipline because I know it's discipline born out of great love for me. Discipline born out of great love for you. So he wants you and I to fear him in that sense. But that kind of fear in God is not common around today, is it? It's not altogether always common in the church, and it's certainly not common outside there in the world. Psalm 36:1 tells us that for the wicked, often there's no fear of God before their eyes. This is why people do what they do, because they don't fear God. They don't think of him even either existing, or they think of him as just simply sort of a grandfather in the sky. He'll just kind of pat you on the head and give you a Werther's candy and say, it's all going to be fun. Boys will be boys. But that's not what God's like. So Peter tells us here the reason we should conduct ourselves in fear is that God the Father is our judge. But there's one other thing he says in verses 17 through 21. He has another reason that he wants us to live in the fear of God. Notice what he says. Starting in verse 17, if you call on him as Father who judges impartially each according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile life or ways inherited from your forefathers. not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb, without blemish or spot. He, that is Jesus, was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Peter's point is simply this. Conduct yourself in fear because you know what Jesus Christ has done for you, right? I mean, conduct yourself with fear knowing that you were ransomed. You were ransomed. If you connect the two, if there's some disconnect, there's something wrong, right? But if you really know that you were ransomed, if you really know that you were delivered from something, then how could you not live in fear? This idea of being ransomed comes actually from the slave market in the first century, a vastly different sort of form of slavery than we've had in our generations, but nonetheless, slavery still back in that day. And a slave back in the first century could be set free. A price would have to be paid. A monetary value was attached to that individual to secure their freedom. Somebody could literally purchase a slave, and they could ransom them, and then they could free that slave. They could set them free. You're a free man. You're a free woman. You can do what you like. It's that backdrop. Peter says, you know who ransomed you from the futile way of life that you inherited? Jesus. Jesus did this to you. It's not a monetary ransom. It's the life of Jesus. You're free because of the price he paid and his death on the cross for you. And Peter's point is simply this. Do not conduct yourself then in a way that treats the ransom of Christ as if it's something not of value, something not precious. Live in fear then. When we live in fear of God, we give him that rightful honor and respect, the reverence and awe that he deserves as our holy God. When we live in fear, we make it our aim then and our desire to live for him and please him in all things, although we do that imperfectly. And then the last thing I want you to note, in verses 22, all the way down to 2, verse 3, is that Peter says we're supposed to live in love. Live in love. Now, there's a lot in this passage, but I want to try to give you sort of the flyby of this passage to understand what's happening. Peter goes on in the text to say, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. I want you to note why he tells them they do this. Verse 23, since you've been born again, that's how you do this. Friends, the only way we can really truly love in the way that we're called to love is if we're born again. True brotherly, sisterly love comes out of that reality. And Peter says, this is how I want you to love. This is a love not like the world loves. We're not talking about loving those who are your own. We're talking about loving those who are your own and those who are not your own, those who you might find unlovable. You're called to love them, and so am I. Peter then says in verse 23, since you've been born again, here's the reason why you should love, because you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and abiding word of God. That, when that happens, when you're born again, your life changes, right? Your life changes. You now can set your hope on Jesus, waiting anxiously and patiently for his return, ready to go. You can now live in holiness because of him, not because you have the power on your own to do it. You can now live in fear and out of reverence and awe of God because you know that he's the righteous judge and you know what he's done for you in ransoming you, and you can live in love because of the fact that you've been made new, you've been born again. This passage goes on to tell us, when you look at chapter 2, verse 1, Peter then says, so, in other words, therefore, in light of what I just finished telling you, put away all malice and all deceit and all hypocrisy and evil envy and all slander. He lists out a bunch of sort of sins, if you will. And his point is that loving one another, what does it include? Well, it includes actually dealing with those things that are antithetical. They're opposite of, right? They're against actually loving one another. I mean, when I'm have malice and deceit and envy and slander. I'm not loving others. Peter's point is you've been born again. Get rid of that stuff. Get rid of it. When you feel the sort of the swell of this, the rise of this in your heart, get rid of it. Don't let it in there. You know, I know the one thing that'll destroy a church quicker than anything else is that stuff. That'll do it. I believe this 100% over all the years of ministry I've been in. Nothing from the outside can destroy this church. Nothing. Nothing. The gates of hell can come against Jesus' church, and the gates of hell will not destroy the church. But what will happen is from the inside, and that's how Satan loves to work. He loves to begin by creating malice and slander and hypocrisy and envy and deceit and a whole host of other things. Friends, you've been born again. Live different than that. Resist those impulses of the flesh. Resist those things and say, I will protect this church. Just like in the old football games, we must protect this house. You know that kind of attitude? Protect this house by protecting and guarding your own heart. Live in this kind of way. Friends, all of this is really unique. Peter calls us to live or conduct ourselves in a way or manner that is foreign to the strange world in which we live. Because we're strangers living in a strange land. We conduct ourselves in this way, as we've seen, because we're so grateful for his indescribable gift of salvation that he's given to us. This is not work for us. This is joy for us. As those who've been born again, we have the joy of living in hope. We have the joy of living holy. We have the joy of living in fear. And we have the joy of living in love. And when we do that, the world will look upon you like you own 1,000 cats. But a whole lot better, because you got Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. I love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love your word. We cherish it. Lord, my heart's so full this morning. Fill our hearts, God, with just a greater love for you this morning, a love for one another. Lord, this week as we enter into this world that we walk around in, our people that are around us, our friends, our neighbors, our communities, our co-workers, wherever we go, Lord, may we go as on mission, but may we go, Lord, and living with that hope and living in that fear and reverence and awe of you and living in holiness, Lord, and Lord, living in love. Would you use us for your glory? We just surrender ourselves to you. Thank you, Lord, for your work in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.